So I've told you before that you need to use the IPA chart. It's not the end-all, be-all of linguistics, but it's a great place to start, even if you ignore all the symbols. IPA stands for the International Phonetic Alphabet. It's a useful tool for describing certain sounds and giving them universal symbols so that you don't have to come up with different ways of expressing the 17 different ways you can pronounce the letter R. And I'm only exaggerating slightly when I say there's 17 ways because I can think of at least 10 right offhand. So let's look at the chart. This is the main grid describing consonants. You probably know what they are, but the official definition is they are obstructions in the airflow. The grid is ordered by the type of obstruction on the left and the place in the airflow where it happens along the top. Let's go over the types first. The proper term is manner of articulation, and they are somewhat organized from more closed at the top to more open at the bottom. First one is a stop plosive. A stop plosive completely stops the airflow and or explodes it like your typical P, T, or K. Also the glottal stop, which you can hear when British people say button. Button, button, can you help me sew on a button? I lost a button, oh no. Nasal sounds pass through the nose instead of through your mouth. Your mouth is closed and the air goes through the nose. A trill is a rapid stopping and opening of the airflow like or the Spanish double R. Perrito, for instance. A tap flap is like a trill, but you only do it once. Like when an American says butter. 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 Fricatives are perhaps the noisiest sounds as they go for the most vibration while only partially restricting the airflow. You can hear a fricative easily. V, sh, z, oh. Those are all fricatives. Meanwhile, an approximant is the smallest amount of restriction you can have and still be called a consonant. Yeah, ruh. Those are approximants. I skipped over one there, but it's for a good reason. The lateral sounds are slightly different because your tongue gets in the way and splits the airflow down the middle so that the air has to go around it. The L sound is the easiest example of a lateral sound. It's a lateral approximant. Ugh. Air goes around your tongue. Lateral fricatives flatten the tongue even more, causing the distinctive fricative sound at the sides of the tongue instead of over the top of it. We don't have any of those in English. That's kind of a rare sound. Now to the top of the grid! The places of articulation, that's an actual term, are ordered from left to right, starting with the lips and going down the vocal tract to the glottis, which is technically the hole in between your vocal cords. First off, you have bilabial, which is using both lips to make a sound, like an English B or a German V, W. Next is labiodental, the bottom lip to the upper teeth. It never works the other way around, as in the English V, V. The next several involve the tongue, specifically the blade of the tongue, which is that flat part just behind the tip. Dental is tongue to teeth, alveolar is the top of that ridge just behind your teeth, and post-alveolar is just behind that, where it starts to slope up into your hard palate. The IPA considers these three places to be kind of the same for most sounds, except for the fricatives, where they have very distinctive sounds. For instance, going from dental, alveolar, post-alveolar, it's whereas with other sounds, you can make a T sound in any of those places and they kind of sound the same. However, some languages and dialects exclusively use one position over the other, and there are ways to mark that. We don't need to know that, just know that it's possible. For example, some Spanish speakers always use the dental position to say their D sounds, which makes their D sounds sound a lot like hard the sounds. D, D. Retroflex is the final one using the tongue's blade. It has your tongue curl all the way up, almost to the hard palate. It's where you get the stereotypical sound of someone from India. And you can even use the back of your tongue instead of the blade, so you sound like India. Now we're gonna start ignoring the blade and we're gonna move on to the body of the tongue. In palatal, the middle of your tongue is raised to the hard palate. The roof of your mouth is in your typical yeah sound. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Velar means you're using the soft palate, which is the softer part behind your hard palate, as in king. Both of those sounds come from your hard palate, from your soft palate. I mean. The next one is the uvular, which is not something we use in English, but you're pushing your tongue all the way back to your uvula, that little thing that hangs down the back of your throat. Fair warning, if you're not used to making those types of sounds, doing them over and over can make you feel like you're gonna throw up. There's a small lack of consensus on the next two, as if they're actually parts of each other that we're describing in different ways, but whatever. Pharyngeal refers to the pharynx, which is basically the top of your throat, right behind the uvula and the tongue, whereas glottal refers to the glottis, the gap between your vocal cords. Button. So that's all the labels. So now let's just look at the grid itself. Many spaces are blank, which means they haven't been, they haven't bothered to assign a symbol there because they haven't officially determined that a real word language uses that particular combo. The last new symbol was for the labiodental tap flat in 2005, which itself was first documented about 100 years ago. So they're not in a hurry to change things. Squares that are grayed out have been judged to be impossible, like making a nasal sound in your throat or a lateral sound with anything other than your tongue.
But I would disagree with that.
But now look at the filled in boxes. Sometimes you'll have pairs of symbols. The ones on the left are considered unvoiced, while the ones on the right are voiced. Voicing is the act of using the vocal cords to make a sound while you're pushing air out of your mouth. For example, you only really find unvoiced sounds in the fricatives and the stop plosives because not voicing the other manners of articulation doesn't really make a sound. So there you go! Those are the consonants. Well, the pulmonic consonants. Pulmonic meaning made with your lungs, and I didn't even cover all of those since there's some that don't fit on that handy graph, like the W sound, which is a double approximant happening between your lips and with your tongue in the velar position at the same time. They're in a list here underneath, and you can figure them out on your own by reading the descriptions. Above that is a section of non-pulmonic sounds. These are the sounds not produced with your lungs, like clicks, implosives, and injectives. And then, of course, over here is the vowels, and this entire section of diacritics that modify the hell out of everything else, creating literally hundreds of new possibilities. And I will help you understand all of those next time, because this video is way too long. Okay, bye. Come on. Running out of time, phone. I'm standing here in my underwear, messing with my phone, which has suddenly to stop. Decided to stop working. Yes, I'm in my underwear. Don't judge me. Here we go.